Good afternoon to you all. Thank you for coming today, and on behalf of Andy and his family, we thank you for being part of this day. Diane and I had talked about this several times. And she said, "Don't be boring." And I remember that last day in hospital, Andy, when you met with the doctor, and the doctor said that this was not going to last very long. And the doctor left, and Andy said to Diane, "This is pretty bad." Diane looked at Andy and said, "Could be worse." I think most of you have heard her say that. Could be worse. And that smile that filled her face, and how she would fill the room when she entered. We're going to be asking you over the next few moments, how do you remember Diane? What comes to your mind when you see her picture? When you shake Andy's hand? You look at her family. What happens inside? I'm going to be asking you over the next while, how do you remember Diane? The last time she and I were together, I read her a passage of scripture that is sort of mine. I quote this or read this virtually every day. It's in Isaiah chapter 54. Listen to the words of God. "For a small moment, you may think I have forgotten you, but with great mercies will I gather you to myself. You may even think that I have hidden my face from you for a moment, but with everlasting kindness will I have mercy on you, says the Lord, your Redeemer. For the mountains shall depart and the hills be shaken and removed, but my love for you will never depart, and neither shall the promise of my peace be removed, says the Lord who loves you. O you who are afflicted and tossed as though in a storm today, behold, I've laid fine stones of fair color as a foundation and a heritage for you, and all the children of God, and all your children shall be taught of God, and great will be my peace to your children." And Diane said, "I know. I know." That inner peace that came from her assurance, that came from her confidence in her faith. Let's bow and ask God to be with us as we remember. Our Heavenly Father, we come to you with 1,000 questions. Why? Why now? Why her? Why this way? But Father, she would say, could be worse. And for her, it's now all better. But we are having trouble. And so we ask your presence with us as we remember, as we gather, as we honor her. May you guide what we say and do. Hear our prayers, we ask. In Jesus' name. Amen. I'm going to ask Andy Weststeyn Jr. if he'd come at this time and bring some memories of his mother.
Feels like I should be giving a sermon or something. All right, so everybody, I am Andy Weststeyn Jr., so I know. So my dad over there is the senior. And Yeah, I want to share some background and some stories. So it always helps to have these on. I'm going to share some stories about my mom. You will all have different connections, experiences, and memories. Sometimes it's nice to have a pause. Okay. And regardless of all our interactions, I know we would all agree that she is an amazing and inspiring woman. My mom was born in 1937 in Holland, in a town called Bodeglaven. I know I said that good too. She was one of seven kids, although one of her sisters died at a young age from malnutrition during the war. So growing up during those times was not easy. My mom was a hardworking woman, and she had to make money with a job to help support the large family she came from. And this was probably the base that gave her the strength she needed many years later when she became ill. My mom was 19 years old when my dad and her first met. And this was only a few days before my dad was drafted into the army. They connected with each other after he came home for a long weekend, and they clicked right away. They dated for a while and got engaged in 1958, and then they were also married in April of 1960. A month later, they emigrated to Toronto, Canada. This was a big change for them, especially since my mom did not know any English, and they were moving to a completely foreign country. But they persevered and were determined to make it work. My dad had a job in a factory as a warehouse worker, and a few months later was promoted to an office job. Then, after a year or so, he was asked to run one of the branches in Montreal. It was only a couple years later in Montreal that my mom became ill and was paralyzed from the waist down. It was a very rare disability, and doctors diagnosed it in the family of MS. She was in the hospital for 6 months, and after that, she was in a rehabilitation center for 3 months. When she went into the rehabilitation center, she was not capable of dressing herself, and she had to learn many things that we take all for granted. She had a lot of occupational therapy, and one activity was woodworking. Mom was so fast that they had to tell her to slow down, since they could not cut the trees fast enough for the wood she used. I remember we had lots of breadboards in our home that she made. It was at the rehab center that she showed exceptional drive and willpower, and the doctors and nurses were all in awe of Mom's determination. She was also determined to get back to her home, and even with all the learning, pain, and suffering, she did. Imagine having three kids and dealing with all of this. I don't remember my mom ever walking, but I do have a memory being with her at that rehabilitation center. I remember sitting on a chair in the waiting room when she was at an appointment, and it took a long, long time. So I started crying. Anyway, at least that helped to shorten the appointment. When my mom came home, she was not going to let paralysis define who she was. She can do anything she set her mind to. She did the cooking and was also a whiz with the finances. If you came to our home, you wouldn't see many differences compared to your home. There was space cut out from under the counter, and that was so my mom could get to the sink. And she also had the stick with the notch so that she could reach all the oven knobs. I think it was also a little burnt on it, so she probably hit a few of those burners. And she had, she also had an intercom that went downstairs and outside, and that was pretty cool for the 70s. My dad would take care of the outdoors and also do the wash and more. They had a routine, and they did great with it. My mom had a workroom in the upstairs of the house in Montreal that she used to get ready in the morning. I remember lots of colored tissue flowers in that room that my sister and her made. It was also her space to be artistic with painting. She loved working with oil paintings and made some amazing ones that still hang in our homes and our friends' homes. Over the years, she had to stop painting because she was in too much pain, and she really missed that a lot. One thing my mom taught us was to always be the best you can be, even when you're not feeling the best. You all know she looked great. She was a classy lady. She loved the sunshine, and she loved to have a tan. She also loved the energy and the warmth the sun gave her. And she also loved sunflowers and You'll see a lot of those today. She also had a lot of clothes with unique jewelry. She was going to make sure that when people looked at her, they were not going to see the wheelchair first. She wanted to make sure that they saw the person in the wheelchair first. I remember days when she could hardly make it out of bed, but she did, and she made sure she looked the best she could. After all, as she said, you will feel better if you make the effort. And this is something we can all do. Make the effort to be the best we can be, despite what is going on in our lives. It may not be easy, but it can be rewarding. Not only did my mom look her best, she also displayed her best with her personality. She was very positive. She would say, you can be better or bitter, it's only one letter difference. She wasn't going to make her struggle the focus. Instead, she was going to make her focus how to overcome the struggles. And this positive attitude helped her and so many that were going through struggles in their lives. She was a great example for others and could relate to many people that were having difficulties. People wanted to know how she did it, and she was so happy to share her story. She inspired many, since if she could do it, then so could they. She provided hope to people who may have felt very hopeless. My parents regularly sang at an Alzheimer's home. They counseled those with cancer. They visited people in the hospital, helped couples dealing with dementia, and a whole lot more. It's not always easy being positive, but it's something we can choose. Don't take what you have for granted, and make sure you enjoy life. My mom always said, there's always someone who's going to go through something much worse than you. My mom also had a great sense of humor. She loved having fun with her kids and her friends. My parents had some great wild parties in Montreal with their church friends. My dad built a balcony from one side of the house to the other. That was great for my mom. But when you add a pool, it also made for a great place to entertain. They would put the volume on high with some Dutch music, mostly Father Abraham, and made the neighbors wish they were there. We also played games, including concentration. This was also one we played with my Oma, which was my dad's mom. She didn't speak any English. My mom and my Oma used to have so much fun and were great friends. My Oma would tell me things in Dutch that I didn't understand, and she would tell me to say it to my mom. One time I was playing the wooden tic-tac-toe game with my Oma. It was always outside on the balcony, and it kind of smelled bad. My Oma said to me, go tell your mom, and of course this is in Dutch, and she said, it ruikt like stroom from a makkebier. So I did, and I went to my mom and told her. I had no idea what I was saying. My mom was laughing so hard. They had a great time together. I found out later the translation is, it smells like poo from a black bear. My mom played the game knuckles with us, and that could really hurt your hands. My brother Pete was the best at it, and I could still hear my mom laughing and saying some other words at that time when she was losing. She also made some great faces for the camera and occasionally took her dentures slightly out to really give us some good laughs. I also remember one time having a Jell-O dessert fight after dinner, and that was pretty funny too. My mom realized the importance of letting go and having fun. It's something we all need to do. We all have to deal with serious stuff, but make sure you take the time to share some laughs. My mom was also a strong Christian with an incredible amount of faith. This gave her strength, hope, and also peace. She knew there were better things ahead for her, and her time on earth was only a stepping stone to her time in heaven. I remember many years ago, probably when I was 17, I was at our home in Coquitlam, and I could hear her crying. I went to her room, and I asked her if she was okay. She mentioned she was having a lot of pain, and she had daily pain. She told me if it wasn't for her faith, she would have been dead a long time ago. I will never forget that. She rarely showed weakness, but even when she did, she recognized her faith in God and his plan. My parents were always actively involved in the church, and they even spoke to the large congregation here in Kelowna. My mom told the story of her struggles, but also her faith, joy, and peace. She inspired many people. My mom turned 80 2 years ago. Her kids and grandkids wrote hundreds of memories and put them in a jar. So that was 2 years to this day. Every day, my mom and dad would read one of those memories. But I know they cheated because they were running out fast. She loved the memories and looked forward to this each morning. And I want to share just a few with you. So thanks for your patience when I had to eat my veggies or no dessert. I remember gagging and eating the canned veggies just so I could get some pistachio pudding. Thanks for buying plants for the garden when we moved into our house. One small plant was a hemlock tree that is now very tall. Now when I look at that tree, I think of you. I remember one Sunday morning, Annette got on the counter and pulled the cupboard, and the whole thing came crashing on the floor. Thanks for not selling Annette to the gypsies after that. And I still think we even went to church that morning. So while we are celebrating my mom's life today, I need to mention my dad. After all, they were a team. He helped her achieve what she accomplished, and he was 100% committed and devoted. He took his job seriously and did a great job as husband and also as father. I know it wasn't easy, but he was right there until the end. I remember talking to him months ago, and this is when my mom was in the hospital. He had a decision to make: move her to a care home or take her home. He said, I need to do what I can to care for her, and brought her home. He knew it was the right decision. In her final days, my mom had significant dementia. She had pulmonary fibrosis, she was really skinny, and she was bedridden. But what was amazing was the qualities she displayed throughout her life could be seen right until the very end. She was still telling jokes. She laughed, she asked how others were doing, and she didn't complain. I remember her saying, "I am content." She passed away peacefully in her sleep. She was content. She did a great job here on earth, and I know she is dancing now in heaven. And that leaves us all here today to not only remember her, but also take all of those amazing qualities that she displayed and incorporate them into our lives. We can inspire others just like she did. We love and miss you, Diane, Mom, and Oma.
And a few. gentle breeze and sings my soul, my Savior God to me.
Diane loved that song. She just loved that song. Can you see her smiling? We can. Peter, Diane's son, has put together a video presentation for us. So watch. Watch these pictures. The life of Diane.
Thank you. see your light is breaking through. The dark of night will not overtake me. I am pressing into you.
The last phrase that was in that presentation, it's hard to forget someone who gave you so much to remember. How do you remember Diane? And how do we say goodbye to her physical presence? Our society has changed so much since she was a girl growing up in Holland, the war, the hunger, the hard times, meeting Andy, immigrating to Canada. She has seen and lived so much change. Yes, our society changes, but people do not. And the circumstances around this day, as we remember her, have shifted. The ceremonies have morphed and taken on new profiles. Some of you may remember some of those old profiles, the black armbands, or when traffic pulled over to the side of the road for a funeral procession. Yes, things have changed, but there are two things that will never change for us. They are mourning and grief. Mourning, you see, is the things we do. They're the things that we put our hands to when words fall so very short and seem so inadequate. So we do something. We write a card, we send flowers, travel to Kelowna. This service, the reception after, through these doors, through the concourse, this doing is our mourning. When we don't know what to say, we do something. But there is a whole lot more, isn't there? There's the inside stuff, the things that we feel, the ache in the heart, the lump in the throat, the wishing, the if onlys, if only I had. Those feeling things are our grief. And hidden in the definition of grief are two ideas, two key words for us today. They are the verbs to remember and to care. Hence my question, how do you remember Diane? Do you remember the first time you met her? I do. I remember that so clearly. This tall, elegant, confident lady with a smile that filled her face and an infectious laugh. Can you hear it? Can you hear her laugh? A laugh that you knew was an invitation to be part of the party that was about to start now that she was there. Andy, remember that first time you met her? You told me about this a couple of times back in Holland. He was going to a movie, and back then you had assigned seats. And he got his ticket and he went to sit in his seat, and here was this woman sitting in his seat. And you know the story. They were married, coming to Canada, Toronto, Montreal, Vancouver, Kelowna. How did she do it? How did Diane manage her joy, her wit, her determination and confidence? Yes, it was her unwavering faith that was a source of her inner strength and contentment. It was the center of her life and her purpose. And we all saw that. Diane was an example of the example. She lived her faith. But you know, there's something else. An addition to the aspect of Diane that we all know. Do you recall how you would say her name? I always said, Diane and Andy. Maybe you said Andy and Diane. Andy, from the first time you saw her next to you at that theater, you have to ask him about it. He even remembers the name of the movie. From that meeting, your marriage, the arrival of your children, the arrival of the wheelchair, the arrival of this day. You have been there. Faithful, loving, fun, confident, unpretentious, kind, peaceful, generous, peace-driven, full of joy. The words that I just said, faithful, loving, fun, confident, independent, kind, peaceful, generous, peace-driven, full of joy are words Andy gave me to describe Diane. But every one of us in this room know that faithful, loving, fun, confident, unpretentious, kind, perfect, generous, peace-driven, full of joy are applicable to Andy too. We know that. How do you remember Diane? I remember coming to Diane and Andy saying, I have a problem. We have a very difficult person that needs somebody to connect with them. Diane said, I'm for it. I gave her the name. There was a young couple in our church, Jane and Willie. In a very difficult circumstance, and I asked Diane and Andy, would you see this couple? How long did you know Diane, or did you know Jane and Willie? How long did you spend with them?
I would say 4 or 5 years.
Yes, hear that? Go visit them. 4 or 5 years later, they're still visiting them. They're over to your house, dinner together. I said to Jane and Willie one time, I said, you know, Diane isn't doing very well. Oh, I said, she was a good friend, wasn't she? Oh, actually, Gordon, Diane was more like Mom. How do you remember Diane? She has asked that we sing a song together. She has asked if you would sing it, not slow, not like at a funeral, she said. It's that wonderful old hymn, Amazing Grace. So let's stand, shall we? And let's sing it like we're at a party. Let's sing it as though, we know what it means. We know that. So let's join together. And we're going to sing all 4 verses, Amazing Grace.
Amazing grace, how sweet the sound that saved a wretch like me. But now I see, 'twas grace that taught my heart to fear, and grace my fears relieved. How precious did that grace appear, the hour I first believed. I have already come. Grace has brought me safe thus far, and grace will lead me home. When we can dare 10,000 years,
seated. There is nothing better to remember someone than to have family talk about them. And I'm going to ask at this time if 2 granddaughters would come, introduce yourselves, and bring us your remembering Oma.
Hi, everyone. Thank you all for coming. Your attendance here speaks volumes about the impact that this wonderful woman had on all of us. We're Diane's granddaughters. I'm Melissa, Pete's daughter, and I'm Dana, Andy's daughter. Diane was known to us as Oma, and we are so lucky to have shared so many great memories with her. We'd like to share with you a couple things that we will never forget about our beautiful Oma. Tic-tac. I'm sure all the grandkids can relate to this one. We always knew that if Oma wheeled into the room, if she reeled into the room with a dish towel on her lap, she would soon be unveiling a collection of Tic Tacs, usually the orange kind. Style. Have you ever seen a more beautiful and put together woman? Oma always had the best and most unique clothes. When you look good, you feel good, and I believe Oma is a testimony of that. It didn't matter the occasion, her hair and makeup were always done, her outfits were amazing, and she was always wearing a smile. Dancing. Even though she spent most of her life in a wheelchair, that didn't stop Oma's love for dancing. I remember one summer when we were visiting, I walked into the kitchen as Oma was dancing around the kitchen in her wheelchair, listening to I'm Alive by Celine Dion. The last time that I visited Oma, she told me that she can't wait to dance again. I'm sure she's dancing right now. Food. Let's face it. We all looked forward to visiting because we knew we'd be spoiled with Oma's amazing food. I remember the dinner table being jam-packed with so many amazing dishes. The most memorable dish, her soup. Oma's famous chicken little soup was a family favorite. We always started dinner with a salad and maybe one or two bowls of soup. 3 to 5 of the grandkids are vegan now, so it's been a while since we got to enjoy the famous soup. But she always made sure to accommodate us when we came to visit, which was not an easy task. I remember one time, Opa threw his hands in the air saying, "I don't know what the heck to feed all of you." But Oma always figured it out. Balance. Something that Oma always said was that calories don't count on the weekends. Oma cooked and ate healthy, delicious meals, but also never said no to dessert. Balance and moderation is something that Oma believed was key to living a happy life, and that is something that I will always carry with me. Positivity. Oma was always smiling. No matter what life threw at her, she always chose to make things better, not bitter. Even with the worst of days, if you asked her how she was doing, she would respond with, "We're doing as good as we can." I remember one time we brought Kiwi, our dog, up for a visit, and Opa kept saying how ugly she was. For reference, she does look and sound like a little pig. But Oma looked at me and said, "Meh, I still think she's a little cute." Emails. Growing up, we didn't get to see Oma very often because we lived in Vancouver and she was up in West Kelowna. Oma was so great at keeping in touch with all of her friends and family all over the world through email. I remember emailing back and forth with Oma every single day. One of her favorite things was to send us virtual greeting cards on Yahoo. I loved sending and receiving these greeting cards and will never forget the excitement of receiving a new email from Oma. Humor. She was always making jokes and finding ways to cheer people up. I remember on our last visit, my dad asked her if she was drinking all her fluids and she responded with, "Only whiskey." She was always trying to make people laugh. Loving. The kind of love that Oma felt for us was a love without condition. She may not have approved of everything we did, may not have liked some of the decisions we made, but she didn't lecture, she didn't judge. She just kept loving us, letting us know that she was there, and she always was. When we love someone, it's hard to let them go. But nothing is eternal except our love for our family. When we keep them in our hearts and remember all the good stuff we had together, they can live forever in our memories. We love you, Oma, and we know that you will live forever in these memories.
Another favorite song of Diane's.
Oh,
Let's bow and thank God for Diane. Oh God, our friend, our Savior, our coming Lord, this day is yours, and we offer you acceptance of whatever you send. For some, you have sent suffering and toil and trouble, but you've also sent joy and laughter and belonging. Ennoble us far beyond our own means, because it comes through the greatest gift that you could give us, your love, through your Son, Jesus Christ. We thank you for giving us Diane as well. We thank you for giving us Diane and Andy. And we ask that you would help us through this time, because there's a part of us that wants to pray and ask you to change your mind. But we cannot. So instead, we are asking your help to understand your mind, your will, and yield to it. I ask for this family and these friends. I ask that your loving kindness and watchfulness would be with them. And may we all find you through this day, beneath all the surprising little disguises that are your love for us. Hear our prayers, we ask, in Jesus' name. Amen. The family have prepared a reception, so please follow them through these doors, through the concourse, into the reception area. Join them. Tell Andy your Diane story.
Thank you. Thank you.